Hey, Schwartzie, and this high center DVA, etc. This is my sidekick, it's mom and pop's Torah, myself and Olivia, my wife, and we're the proud parents of Mendel. And I'm very thankful also really to the post can be the Kvodach Sanya. The Torah says you should begin with the honor of the host and hostess. So me and Brad, I know you just a few years, and they said tolerate me, I can't believe it. And let me come to their home with strangers. I think I might have called you up once. I wanted to have a party. And I said, well, I'm going to have a party with 200 people. I want to go to your house. You know, one of those. And it's just nice. So, seniority. I think you and I were by the Rabbi for Simchas Torah.
Yep. You were actually under the chuppah with us.
Right, until they got married.
Yes, that's and right.
And your kids were like, what? Graduate college or something? You know?
Yes.
That's what I remember. So we've been around for a while together. That's always nice. So I want to say that I was just talking with some people before.
Cheers.
L'chaim, l'chaim. Ancho, l'chaim. Welcome. Bienvenidos, my boy. I was also at his chuppah.
That's correct.
Excuse me. So after a while of doing this topic, pretty much, it was once upon a time called relationships, how they work, why they don't. The other is how not to get divorced, how to stay married, and things like that. So for three New Year's Eves every 2 years, my wife and I went to, once we lived in Vienna Hilton, once in Prague, once in Amsterdam, and there in those weekends, there were 600 Jewish college students from 17 countries in Europe. The common language was English, German, etc. So, but they went for a weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, which coincided with New Year's. And one time, Hanukkah and New Year's came out together. So I had all these funky decorations and earrings that I had, and they all wanted to take a picture with me to show their family, the rabbi from America, from California, because I have these. Because in Europe, everything is, you know, New Year's Eve ball. Everybody comes with gowns, and I even came in sneakers, jeans, and the earrings flashing with their Hanukkah. But I say, you know, and as soon as we started the brachas, every boy went for a napkin. Tremendous respect. Different, very beautiful. But my session on relationships was the most packed. Otherwise, there, you know, it was Friday night, they had the kippah after Shabbat, or a chef from Israel, they're smoking in the lobby, and then we can get that. They're very interested in Judaism, and anyway, this was a topic, but these are college kids, 18 to 21. I did this maybe 8 times for people in their, let's say, 40s, mostly 50s and 60s, so sometimes married twice or thrice. And that's a lot of experience. How does the Torah define wisdom? Who's a wise person? Who's a sage? What about if you're stupid? Can you still be a sage? What about you're unlettered? If you're illiterate, can you still be a wise person? Well, what do the goyim say? Experience is the best teacher? Okay, what do the Jews say? What does the Torah say? Ein chacham, any Hebrews over here, Israeli kind of people? So you check up on me? Okay. Ein chacham, what does that mean?
There's no wise one.
No wise one. Kibal nisayon.
Like
an experienced person. So people who are laity, if this is not what you do, you're like you have a straight job, you know, a day gig, but you have friends, intimate, very close friends that talk to you about their personal private lives that goes on behind closed doors, that's called anecdotal wisdom. My computer printout tells me that today I know 4,000 singles and 2,500 couples. The singles have been married once, twice, thrice, so have the couples. Sunday afternoon, that's when I'm 44 years in my ministry here, that's when I do, you know, third timers, let's say. So 10 years ago, It was 52%, and today it's actually 62% divorce rate. That's for first marriages, and 6.9 years. Second marriages, 5.4 years, because I've been there, done that, it's easier the second time. For the first time, since my parents were divorced, because it's 62%, that means two of the three couples will get divorced. It's like when I was a campus rabbi for 20 years at UCLA, I think you know that, a lot of you. And so this chemistry, I was with this guy for 4 years as an undergrad. I was going to be a chemistry guy. And so he said to me, he told me his story, that since he's 5 years old, his uncle gives him $50 on his birthday, and he says, "Okay, little Stevie, what are you going to do with the money?" And he says, "I'm saving it for college." That's when till 18. So 18, "Okay, Stevie, what are you going to do with the money?" He says, "I'm saving it for alimony and child support." So let's define the problem. We live with the facts. Defining the problem is important. It's a complicated situation because it's the only time when people really aren't thinking that clearly. That's why it's important to take an impartial, objective person, not necessarily a friend, not necessarily a peer. I'm talking about before you get married, before you make life-changing decisions. I asked this couple, the mother sent them to me, I don't know what she thought I was going to do with this couple. She's not Jewish, no surprise. He's Jewish, I shouldn't change it. You know, they're getting married, they're engaged, they've been living together for 3 years. Boom, I should take my magic wand, wind up, and change the world. Okay, it's not going to happen. But, so I asked them the simple, most obvious question. I said to them, "Well, what's the answer to the simple, most obvious question that anyone would ask a pre-intermarried couple?" And they said, "What's the obvious question?" "Well, you're young, you're getting married. How are you going to raise the children?" So in the same breath, at the same time, they said Christian Jewish. She said Christian, he said Jewish. I said, "Hello, you've been living together for 3 years. Has it been all nonverbal communication? Have you guys been talking? Hello, everybody home here? Are you kidding me? You guys been together? I had one phone number at that time, it was no cell phone. You had one phone number for the last 3 years. You never discussed this topic. Life is wasted on the young, okay, but you know, I find that second timers or even third timers still have that, I think, reprehensible naivete. Because you're making wrong decisions and making bad judgment calls. I mean, some people repeat it almost with the exact history. So, the other thing is, I was just saying before also that when a couple get engaged, so then it breaks down a lot of social mores. You know, there's sometimes uncomfortable to be around. You hear the chant growing louder in the room, "Get a room, get a room." You know, "Hello, we know you love it. Okay, you're getting married. You made that decision. That's nice." But in these very same couples, in 6.0 or 3.0, you know, whatever, 1.8 children, 2.2, whatever it is, they don't want to sit in the same room together for an extra hour, because that's how long it takes to do the religious divorce. To get married by a rabbi, you're supposed to get divorced by a rabbi. It's called a get. It takes a bunch of rabbi. I mean, it's a whole, and he has the scribe is writing it as you don't take them out of the freezer. They do it on the spot, custom made for you. We have to get more rabbis and do all kinds of convoluted, she should come in later and he should be, because they don't want, you've been married for 11 years, you were together. You have 2.8 children. You can't sit in the same room for an hour. You love me, you know, you are just in half. And that kind of hatred is ugly. Especially when people have been together like that. Parents with children. Now it's the convoluted situation of a rabbi in town, and his grandson is getting married. Well, there's a divorce in the family. What a mess that is. We rabbis have to make, I mean, I'm talking for the in crowd here, have to make Kissinger diplomacy, but I said, your children and your grandchildren are growing up in classes, in high school, where very few people have the same you know, the bottom of the invitation to a wedding looks like a laundry list. Red pen and this pen and this pen and that. How did it get so far apart like that? People are uncomfortable, they can't stop. They are expressing their love to each other, and now what's gonna be? Have to do all kinds of, so there is a difficulty. So that's what I put. Love, that was the big one I messed up, is a big mess. 67, 62%. Now just compare it to, so what's the answer, the solution? What did I say? So who's the best judge of human nature? There's 32 different schools of behavioral science. There's the Freudians and the Jungians and the, you know, pick one and spin it like a dreidel. There's 32. But let's just go to the top, Freudian and Jungian. So Freud was a Jewish guy, and when he got married, he told his Jewish wife, he's Jewish, Sigmund Freud, he told his Jewish wife, you know what, I know you came from a very Orthodox family, but I can't have you lighting Shabbos candles in my home. I can't. Because I'm the one who wrote that religion is a father neurosis. So, and you're going to bring that, I can't have that. So, but Jung was the son of a Protestant Christian minister, very big into God, very big. I remember I was watching with my wife this at Art Theater Santa Monica, a documentary on Carl Gustav Jung. And the interviewer asked him, he's old, he's just before he died, in the 30s or something, he's, you know, his long white hair and his like white beard. And, cherubic smile, spoke very slowly. The interviewer asked him, do you believe in God? And everybody, including me, went in the front of there, you know, I'm out of a job in 2 seconds. and he, do you believe in God? And so he repeated the question, do I believe in God? And then he smiled and he said, I don't believe in God. I know there's a God. He said with tremendous sincere conviction. And because he had sort of invented a few words in the Webster Dictionary. One is psyche. P-S-Y-C-H-E. That's the word in Goyish for soul. Then he wrote 12 books. And the last book is very powerful. He writes in italics, which means it's not English, the two words in Hebrew, Yetzer Hara.
Mm-hmm. Evil inclination.
Yes, evil inclination. He wrote something even more profound. Sorry?
Yeah.
He wanted to give us something more profound. He said that everything that I know to be true by my personal experience with his patients over so many decades, and being a student and disciple of Freud as well, etc., etc., everything I know to be true was intuited by a Hasidic rabbi a century ago named Dov Ber of Mizrich.
Whoa.
I have a son, Gingy boy, Beryl, my Beryl. Named after that rabbi. The successor to the Baal Shem Tov who founded an ism in Judaism called Hasidism, Rabbi Israel Baal Shem Tov, 1,300 years ago. His successor, disciple, protege, was Dov Ber of Mizrich. He had 10 students, and one of them, that's where all the Hasidim are. The 10 students of Dov Ber of Mizrich. So, getting back, if we can, I sometimes, you know, I used to, when I first came, I was in my 20s, I was 70, I was a campus rabbi. So once a month, we get a phone call. This couple's married, they want to speak to a rabbi. I'm 25 years old, you know, are you kidding me? I know nothing. I had a little baby in it. And now, you know, it's 44 years later, so now it's like there's 3 calls a week. About, and they're all tragic. I spoke to a boy I met when he was 15. Now he's 40 years old. He's a rabbi in Toronto. And he's, maybe he's older. So he says to me, Schwartzie, you know, I've been a decade. He married the Chazan's daughter in Toronto, Orthodox synagogue, large Orthodox community. He says, I thought I was going to teach Gemara. I said, I thought I was going to teach Tanya. Mm-hmm. Now, come on. And he says, I deal in tragedy.
Wow.
It's talking about the number one social ill that affects so many people. War of the Roses, Kramer versus Kramer. Look at the movies. She was like an out. Olivia used to teach, my wife used to teach a Torah class for women in Malibu. She has five women. And between, you know, before it started, at the end, so the women would discuss their exes and how it came to be. Because they're all the women living in Malibu, so they're doing, they did well, whatever it was there. And it came out to like, this one spent $250,000 to kill her. I mean, you know, this one spent a lawyer's fees and over the full custody. But, you know, everybody got what they're supposed to get here. They spent millions of dollars. Now it's 15 years later, and people are talking to each other. Nobody's getting anywhere, you know, getting back together. But, you know, coffee once a month with the people they didn't spend money to, I mean, to learn. But it's just, and they didn't go anywhere. Some will be married to other people, etc. It's shocking as a public practitioner, that'd be me, to take people from the stage of, I found the person I'm going to marry, I want you to marry, I want you to come to whatever it is, and to see a number of years later, I married a couple in the Presidio in San Francisco about 12 years ago. Now, it snows in San Francisco once every 50 years. They had the chuppah set up right to marry them. It was a beautiful place they had. I know them from a long time ago. We were actually Woodstock together, me and this guy.
Cool.
And it was just Woodstock 2, actually.
94.
You're right. So he was a big fan of Canned Heat.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a long story, but we got on stage. There was only a few left, almost all of them, they're all dead, they OD. But there's a few guys still living. And this guy played bongos for kids. Everybody was so stoned, it was just like, you know, 300,000 people. No one knew, but he got on stage, and my friend played bongos on stage with Canned Heat. He just was in heaven. So anyway, they got married, and I pushed them. She was 5 years older than him. And I said, listen to me, this looks great to me. And so they had a place, a cabin, all together, and that. And he did something very bad. And I said, she said, we're alone on the weekend. I mean, me and my wife and her and a bunch of people to the holiday, went to a place they had in the Big Bear. And she said, and he did something, he did a bad thing. And she said, is he worth it? I said, yes. So I had 11 good years. It's like a ubiquitous plague. And two generations ago, didn't happen. A strong question. How could you not ask the question? People in pain. People want to be in love. People we know, relatives, you know, stuff like that. The only thing good about second marriage is you don't take it for granted. I'm not going to make some of the same mistakes that I made last time. But it's like it's everywhere. It's a big mess. So, who should you ask? Since there's so many different schools of thought in the area of science, in terms of, is there any solution about it? Changing about how we change attitudes, what we need to change. What's the medicine for this ill? If you're sick, you go to a doctor. I never saw a status quo in a marriage. Never. Now, my computer comes out tells me, you know, today I know 4,000 singles and 20,000 couples. That's 9,000 people. That's today. What about 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago? I was in the valley of the Bar Mitzvah, Shari Tzedek, the biggest Orthodox synagogue in the whole valley. I was there Shabbos, went for a Bar Mitzvah. And two women come up to me and say, Schwartzie, I love you. I remember what you said at my chuppah. She tells me what I said at her chuppah. Underneath the wedding canopy that I officiated, and she has already children, and then the mother-in-law's there. So the mother-in-law's looking at her, getting nervous. Schwartz, I love you. Who's this man? And the husband says, fine. And she says, so when she finished, I said, no, that's very nice. Well, I don't remember what that I said in the chuppah, but the problem is where did that? I don't remember you. I don't remember. And so, you know, I'm pushing 70. It's just, When there's people over 70, there's three things they forget, you notice? Where they park their car. Second thing, actually, excludes the first thing, because they don't remember where they put their keys. Yeah, so even if, and the third thing, I don't remember. But so the change of attitude, though, something has to be done to, people think about cancer. I mean, it's everywhere, it's almost everywhere, and it's a terrible thing, and it's affecting people very bad. What about if your marriage is sick? Wouldn't it be logical to get a marriage doctor? I mean, something. What's his name? Who's the film critic on the radio? Medved, right? What's his first name?
Michael Medved.
Michael Medved is very happily married to his second wife, who wrote the case against divorce, Nancy Medved. There's only one book like that. Most books are saying, throw the bomb out, just live that, you know, it's more, there's no case against divorce. There's not a lot of books like that. There's a lot of books the other way. How to kill your significant other in three easy lessons that shouldn't cost you a lot of money. Or whatever, you know, whatever they're doing with it. So who's the best judge of human nature? The one that invented it. The one that created it. Somewhere along the line, we're going to have a shift in attitude, because the way of denying the quote-unquote other reality is not working. I remember seeing place, and what was it? You can make your own custom-made bumper stickers. I was a big fan of bumper stickers. I had, you know, 35 bumper stickers, but I never got to enjoy them because they were in my drawer. But I had a big Suburban. I had a Baruch Hashem, 12 children. I took to yeshiva, to day school. They were cringing and embarrassed. I love my bumper sticker collection. One of the rabbis gave to me. He dropped the kids off at day school, Hebrew school, Hebrew Academy. And one, there was one bumper sticker that was, people was running around with, and it said, "He who dies with the most toys wins." So I did the same thing, but I put a question mark at the end of the sentence. Is that all there is? There ain't no more? Is that all she wrote? "He who dies with the most toys wins." There's got to be something else. And the price difference, the price between medical waste and the price of the limit. Anyway, there's got to be something else. So, because the nature of the consumerism, materialism here and now is mi sheyesh lo maneh rotze matayim. What does that mean? Where's the Hebrew people?
Someone wants 100, wants 200.
Someone who has 100 wants 200, someone has 200 wants 400. That's one of the natures. The other nature is ein adam meit v'chatzi tavutav biyadav. Great limerick, one line in Hebrew. Ein adam meit, what does that mean?
Doesn't die.
No man dies.
And half of his desires.
And half of his desires fulfilled. Within his hand. Nobody dies with even half their ambitions fulfilled. So if it's not going to work in that direction, what's the other direction? Limitlessness. Infinity. What does the Kabbalist call God? There's 10 names of God, 7 that can't be erased. No book except for books of Kabbalah called God by, but all the books of the Kabbalah exclusively and unanimously call God by one name, and it's not any one of those 10 names. Shiva Shemot Shinonim Hakim. What name do the Kabbalists call? They're the people who know about God. They're the scientists of it. Hashem is good, I love to correct. Hashem means the name. That's a name for God colloquially, but not the name the Kabbalists use in the books of Kabbalah, which is the science of God. What are the, come on, go ahead, I want to hear wild guesses. I like it so.
In
Sorry?
Oh, that's right.
In the name of President Kabbalist. What's your name?
Ashley.
Ein Sof. That's the other part of flawlessness, perfection, totality, completion, complete. If you're connected to limitlessness, to infinity, then you have everything. Immortality, infinity. Infinity means just as, what does it say in the good book, how did God create man? God created man in God's image. What is the image? Because we all have different images. What is the image of God inside us, in us? It can't be fingerprints because there is, all our fingerprints are different. 6 billion people on the planet, 6 billion different kinds of fingerprints. What do we have that's the same?
So,
that we can even agree upon in one room. Let's see if we can do this. Someone said soul. Well, let's define that a little more better, because some people can say, I have a soul. Not necessarily. I have, you know, I'm alive, but I mean a soul. Other people can explain it. Doctors and scientists can explain the living process of animation, and here's two bodies exactly the same. One is working, one isn't. One isn't is called dead, although nothing's exactly the same. And everything, but this isn't. If we define the soul a little bit, according to Kabbalah, it's not, so it's so much easier to cut to the chase and find out what does God say in the fourth, final, highest level of the Torah. We did this last time or the first time in the intro. The Paradise of Torah, PRDS. It's an acronym. Like IBM, I've been misled, you know those? Fiat, they said you can't tell me, there's a whole bunch of them. So, in the fourth level of paradise, that's a Hebrew word, Pardes, Pei Resh Dal Samach. So there's four dimensions of infinite meanings in the book written by the infinite, capital I for infinite. Pshat, Remez, Drush, Sod. Simple, hinted at, ethical, and secret. Mystical. Metaphysical. Esoteric. So, what were we talking about? The mystical, the hidden, in...
The soul.
Let's try to agree, at least somewhat, that the soul has two parts. The image of God in a human we'll call soul, but what is a soul? Just like God has 10 spheres, and he was spherot, modes of manifestation, tools of revelation, expression. You have three vehicles of human expression. Thought, speech, and deed. Achshava, dibur, maaseh. Those express your 10 soul powers that are descended from God's 10 spheres, as he wrote. The 10 spheres of manifestation of God that's inside you, that's the image of God in you, called soul, can be subdivided into 2, 3, and 7. You follow me? 3 intellect, cognitive powers, 7 emotions. What's the Kabbalistic meditation when you put one, a man puts on tefillin in the morning, between his elbow and his wrist, he winds 7 coils of leather. What is he supposed to meditate on if he's a Kabbalist? Zun, Zo Umalchut, Zer Anpin, the last 7 of the 10, here he puts 3, Chochma Bina Dat. Here he puts Chagat Nihim, Chesed Yorah Tiferet, Netzachot Yisod Malchut. Emotions are neutral. The need of fish nor fowl, not good or evil. Motion of love, the primary emotion. Love for your wife is a mitzvah. Love for someone else's wife is not a mitzvah. So it doesn't work. So emotions, intellect. You can make a cure for cancer. You can bet a bigger bomb to blow up the world 100 times, 10 times. So intellect is also neutral. It depends what you do with it. You can figure out how to do something bad, or you can learn Torah. God's wisdom. What did God have in mind? And he wanted me to do thou shalt and thou shalt not. What was in the divine mind? What's the top level, the most connected to God? The mystical level, the Kabbalistic level, the secret. What's the secret of a happy marriage? Why should people be happy? So, if someone said to you, this is number one, that, listen, I have a great business deal, you're gonna make tons of money, and but there's only a 38% chance that it's gonna be successful. There's a 62% it's gonna fail. Give me every penny of your life savings, borrow money, and I'm gonna make, and I'm gonna invest it, and you have a 38% chance of, it's, you don't go to Vegas for, on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, with your vacation money, and Friday before the sun sets, you put it all on red, or black, or odd even. That's your, I mean, that's 50% return, black, or red, or odds, or even. Yes?
Sorry, can you just repeat how it's divided into two? Did you say emotions and intellect?
Yes, okay. Intellect and emotions, 3 and 7. 3 intellect powers, and 7 emotions. Emotions are, the 3 intellect powers are called mothers. Because ideally, intellect begets emotions. If it's a true emotion, if it's not a vain, fancy infatuation. We have a singles party, our most famous singles party is the Not a Christmas Party every year at Christmas. And that's December 25th from 2 to 5, at somebody's house usually. And a guy comes to me and he says, Schwartzie, I met the girl of my dreams. And I want you to marry us. I said, dude, it's how long you talk? Because, oh, no, we didn't talk. You didn't, hello, anybody home here? So I go to you out to lunch, and there's nobody. Well, there was amazing eye contact. Amazing. And that could get a life, okay? Come on, don't. Doesn't work. That's called emotion out of wedlock, or a legitimate birth. There's no. They're called the mothers because intellect is supposed to beget emotion. That's why there is something to GU, geographic undesirable. It's just, you know, we've been in the face of Skyping forever, but we never met that way, whatever it is. You know. It has to be some, you have to put in some time to invest to make that happen. But again, so that would be a good place to look for the answer to this number one social ill, the one who invented human nature. Well, we're all kind of thing. How does that work? So the inventor, where would you look for that? Is magnum opus? Where is, yeah. Okay, so the main book of God's wisdom is in the Bible, the Torah. So what did it say? Everybody here knows. What did it say in the Torah? Where did it say the most popular, not the first time, but the most popular time that the word love is used in the Jewish Bible? It's actually, who knows where that is?
Song of Songs.
Even before that, Songs is later.
Love your neighbor as yourself.
Yes, good. That's not as popular as the other time that.
Thou shalt love the Lord thy God.
That's it. The Shema.
So with all thy might.
That's 6:5 in Deuteronomy. There it is, right there.
Be upon your heart.
Right. That's the whole first sentence. The second most important sentence in the Jewish religion is thou shalt love the Lord thy God, right after the Shema. Every child who knows nothing, he thinks his Christmas tree is a Hanukkah bush, but he knows Shema, you sure will. That's where you're supposed to say the last moments of your life, if you're conscious. And that's where the child is taught, Shema Yisrael. And there's so much on Shema itself. And delving into, I'm just going to show you for a minute. Where's that red? Where's Azari here? My nephew or my grandson?
Everybody's
they left, huh? I wonder if they left my. Is there a red bag? I sent them out.
Oh my
yeah.
Goodness.
They brought it in.
Oh, it's right here.
Yeah. They take you out to meet you for a minute, if you don't mind. So when I show you get a little bit here, I had so much fun preparing for this because we've been inundated. The problem. So looking for the solution was really enjoyable. Because where can you be confident and feel some security when you're looking for the solution? I feel insecure thinking that human intellect figured out all the solutions. Because if it did, then everybody would be lining up to that guy's door. But it's still, the statistics are going up, not down. It's creating another genre of civilization and society because of children. You know, children weren't from the worst homes. A generation is 25 years. So that didn't happen as much. Now it's more everywhere. So it's one to live differently on a certain level. But I'm thinking if the problem could be more assuaged and that could turn around, that people could be like the 12%. But again, there was something here in Los Angeles called the Jewish Mental Health Association. And I met at Cedar Sinai. And that was, I met once a month. But I was in lockdown, it was like for hours and hours. It was 15 shrinks and 5 rabbis. All the shrinks were Jungians.
What were the shrinks for?
The Jungian School of Psychology.
As opposed
to Freud. Jungian are very, as close as you get to Hasidic mystics, but the Jewish are not. Because he had a lot of this, like he said in his last book, everything I know to be true is intuited by a Hasidic master 100 years ago. I don't know, wow. That stuff wasn't written in English until recently. I don't know who you're studying with. But a lot of that is right, absolutely, in the book of the Tanya, and it comes from the Kabbalah. And this idea of double level of consciousness, that's very powerful. That a person doesn't have a body and a soul, they have a body and two souls. So that's the next thing. In that sentence, where it says, it's a commandment. There's 613 commandments in the Bible. So there's thou shalt and thou shalt nots. How many thou shalt nots are there out of the 613?
Six.
300. The 613 commandments in the Bible. You got me there, right?
365.
So thou shalt and thou shalt not. What do you say?
365.
Yes. It's easy. One no for every day of the year. Boom. 365 thou shalt not take away from 613. You get 240 thou shalt. Okay. Trust me. So that's why when you say the Shema, you can't repeat the last three words. Because there's 245 words in the three paragraphs of the Shema. When the cantor repeats the last three words and you hear that, it goes to the 248, which is symbolic of the commandments in the Bible. One of those commandments in the Bible is to recite the Shema twice a day, every day. Shabbat, holidays, regular weekday, Yom Kippur, every day of your life. When the rises up and when the lies down. So in the Shema is the most important sentence in our religion. The second most important sentence is the one about love. It's a commandment, it's the imperative. Ve'ahavta. And thou shalt love.
The Lord thy God.
Stop. And that, I memorized this. If you interrupt me, I'll forget my whole shtick. So, if thou shalt love the Lord thy God is a commandment in the Bible to say it twice a day. And thou wise thou. Now, yeah. How can God command an emotion? Let's say there's a commandment to love your significant other. Right now, you know, I'm sleeping on the couch, we're not getting along, and it's, you know, it's not, I mean, I did once, I don't know, and I was in lust, I don't know, but, and it's not, love purple. I like blue. Love strawberry. I'm a chocoholic. How can God command an emotion? The successor to the Vashem, to the great Magid of Mizrich, his name was Dov Ber, our son Gingy Boy, one of our two redheads, his name is Dov Ber after him. Barrel, we call him Berry, short for strawberry, because he's a redhead and flaming red beard as a boy. So the Magid said, how do you fulfill that commandment? I know how to fulfill the commandment of light the candles, put up the mezuzah, put the tefillah. How do you fulfill the commandment? I can say it twice a day. That's called recital. Talk is cheap. Caesar can leave home kosten shkagel. It's a vicious Yiddish folk saying. Say, I promise you and I love you, it doesn't cost any money. Ha. So, but it's So what, how do you fulfill that commandment? Thou shalt love.
With actions.
Sorry?
With positive actions towards
your partner. But listen, let's make this rhetorical, because it's actually in the Kabbalah. So that information is divine wisdom. So rather than guess at it, what does God say? Now, what's the practical value of all of Kabbalah? Practical value, human value, utilitarian human value. If we can know how God works, he wrote a book with his wisdom in it. The first word of the Ten Commandments is what?
Anochi.
Anochi, I am the Lord thy God. But it's not the Ani, it's Anochi. Anochi is four letters. Once again, an acronym. Aleph Nun Chof Yud. This will be the first word of the Decalogue, Ten Commandments. Mosaic Law, English or American law, it's coming from high on the big screen. What's this I am the Lord thy God? Anochi instead of Ani? Aleph Nun Chof
Yud.
Ana Nafshi Ketavit Yehavit. I wrote my soul into it. That's the first word. God's talking now. Capital S for soul. God's saying, you want me, you want to grasp me. The word grasp in English and Hebrew has two meanings. I'm grasping the glass. I don't grasp what you're saying to me. To be connected to a concept, to an understanding. Kabbalah teaches about God. That's the subject matter of Kabbalah. Everything else is gravy. That's the only book of the Torah that teaches about the details of the God being, plus the Godhead, and all facets. About, it's not in the Bible, it's not in the Talmud, it's not in the Mishnah, it's not in the Gemara, it's not in the prophets. You want to find God? Then look from where you lost him. Now the drunk is under the streetlight, on all fours looking for something. Then the guy comes by and says, okay, Mr. Drunk, what are you looking for? Let me help you. He says, I lost a $10 bill. Where'd you lose it? 10 blocks east. What are you doing? The light is better.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the hot. Okay, Brad, you have any more? We got vodka and I know something. Thanks.
Flat or fizzy? Flat or fizz?
Yes.
There's no more ice out there.
Yeah, to chill for it. So, no wait about the soul thing? How to fulfill the commandment that we all know about, and the second most important sentence in our religion, we're commanded, and many of us do, say it twice a day. So how do you, we can say it, but the commandment is not to say it. The commandment is to experience it, to feel it. Well, let's say you've been married to somebody for 10 years or whatever. How do you feel that? It is what it is. I mean, it's been good sometimes, good time, bad time. Ups and downs, hills and valleys. Jews are not solar. Jews are lunar. Our calendar goes by the moon. The full moon of Libra is what Jewish holiday?
Sukkot.
The full moon of Pisces is what Jewish holiday? Purim. The full moon of Aries is what Jewish holiday?
Pesach.
We are lunar, not solar. Okay? Solar means it's the same, the sun with the white bread and the male. It's just it never changes. But lunar means it's hills and valleys. Sometimes I love you, since I'm like, I'm nothing Jewish. I'm Jewish light, I'm Jewish zero, I'm Jewish, you know. It depends what, even the times of day, to decades of people's lives. But the idea of, I just wanted to share this with you also. I had so much fun preparing for this here. To love God and theology of sources, so that was one thing to look up. And you know, Tanya is a classic of Jewish mysticism, and there's maybe 60 books that's trying to explain this book, Tanya, a classic in Kabbalah. And Rabbi Steinsaltz wrote a series of books that look like this. And this is really a great, and it's written in the best, most clearest language. And here, the mitzvah to love your fellow as yourself. That's what Bobby quoted. That's the second time let people know about love in the Bible. The first is, thou shalt love the Lord thy God. Jewish people use a partial to that. The next one is known by even the Goyim, 19:18. It's in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. Ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. Same word as in the Shema. Love your neighbor as yourself. Which is almost as difficult to understand as the first time it says, thou shalt love the Lord thy God. Let's say I say the words, I'd like to love God, but I don't feel it. Now, let's be honest. I want to love God, but I like chocolate. I don't like strawberry. I don't like strawberry, and that's so. Let's say thou shalt eat strawberry every Pesach. It's love God. What about love your SO, your significant other? I'd like to, and I think she's great, and I'm a big fan, admire, but right now, we're not talking, okay? We are not. I'm only cash. I don't care anymore. And I said, I've been married all of 3 minutes, and people. So this is a thing that, also, it seems like it was just there. Generation two ago, people weren't doing that. So then they come back at you with, well, that's because they suffered and said they did. Well, maybe, maybe not. Because sometimes, 2 generations ago, there was, let's say, it wasn't divorced at 63% of us, let's say the teens. That means there was a commitment, you have to resurrect that, that there is no such thing as the D word. You may not use that word, it's an obscene word. What is the desire to use that word the most? Even people who married twice or three times. Because, like I told somebody before, it's 150, you know, for this 50-minute hour, but rabbis are double sessions for nothing, so I hear everything. It's even TMI. But I'm happy to have that experience, because if Ein Chacham Kabbalah Nisayon, wisdom is the best teacher, so after 700 weddings, and not from the same people, 200 divorces, and countless hours of pastoral counseling, etc., you get to know a lot of stuff. So, just very, very briefly, yeah?
I have a question back. You mentioned, I just walked back to the room, and you said the body and two souls. So you're talking about the animal soul and the godly soul? The
right, yes. Soul? Yeah. Because there is, that's an important thing to know. Maybe the most important thing, one of the most important things in Kabbalah has to teach us, and that a person is not monolithic. You are not a singularity. You are a double level of consciousness. You have not one, but two souls. One is called the natural soul, doing what comes naturally. What comes naturally? Who is the closest person to you in your life? Yourself. That's what it says in the Torah. Adam karov etzel atzmo. Translation, who are the Hebrews here?
He's close to you, a man is close to himself.
Adam karov etzel atzmo.
Wow.
Every person is closest to themselves. So that's the first, you know, are we having fun yet? I mean, this is, you know, what have you done for me lately? You're married 35 years, are you an idiot? What are you talking about? I mean, we are one. So that, this idea of that commitment, never to do, especially the first year. So I heard from all the people that have been married, sometimes once, sometimes twice, sometimes three times. So I asked them, what was the most difficult? I asked people, like, you know, I'm a gallop pole, a walking gallop pole, because I have a lot of people. And I asked the same questions. Because then it's like, you get, I asked 1,000 people, and that's not an exaggeration, the last 35 years of marrying people, the same question. If 95% of the 1,000 people answer the same answer, so I want to something. So maybe there's some secrets that are coming out. I asked the people, one of the most question that I asked the most was, why did you get divorced? Was it A, you woke up one day, 6.9 years down the line, and next to this monster, who are you? I don't know who you are. What kind of person? I mean, do I have such bad judgment on me that I can't believe it? Or was it B, the reason you got divorced was something that you saw before you got engaged? What did 95% of 1,000 people answer?
The second one. Something saw before. Yeah.
this is, so after a while you figure, so that's the largest chapter in my yet unwritten, unpublished, best-selling book. Don't ignore the obvious. I saw the red flags. How many times did I hear that? Now, it's painful. I like people. Everybody saw that. So, but I was, and then the fill in the blank, so many years dating, and this was, you know, and I didn't want to have a child, and the clock was ticking out. I mean, I know the script, I mean, I heard about it, I know the whole thing. Yes?
But don't married people have that too, that don't get divorced? They also have the red flags, but they work through them. So doesn't everybody have some sort of red flag?
Yeah, well, here we have to break it down. Mm-hmm. I expect a quarter season between 2 and 6 weeks before a wedding that they have to come to the office to see me. Gonna get married in 2 weeks, I know what it is. So they have to come to the office to see me. Okay, which one wants to postpone the wedding? Mm-hmm. He wants to postpone the wedding. Okay, fine. Let's hear the big secret. Why do you want to postpone the wedding? Because the truth is, sometimes it's a something. Sometimes it's, if he can't be specific, then, you know, we'll drag him. Because then it's nothing. I mean, it's just, or even a one-on-one. If it's nothing specific. If you got something specific, and it's something that gives one pause, like physical violence or stuff like that, then something that's unacceptable, then it's a problem. And I would also opt for postponement, because once you postpone it, it dies. I mean, if it's, you know, I thank God I don't have a synagogue. I've been here 40 years with that. I'm sure I'm very happy. And I don't have to marry anybody who asked me to marry them. Because you're not a member of my synagogue. Because I don't have a synagogue. So if I think that somebody, this couple is, I don't think so. Why would I do, you know, I don't have a synagogue, you know, go find another rabbi. I'm not interested. So I lost 5 friends like that. But one of the people I refused to marry, on their anniversary, first year anniversary, I got a call. The rabbi that married them was called to their house, and he went to their house in crisis emergency, and the husband was chasing him around the house with a rifle. Oh. I'm happy I didn't marry them. I'm happy I didn't get a rifle.
Did you answer your question, how to love God? I'm sorry, did I?
So now let's get back to that. So this is the practical value of Kabbalah in general. And that's why it's important to learn Kabbalah. Because let's say Kabbalah has an explanation about how to love God. That's the way you can resurrect love between Jack and Jane, husband and wife. Adam and Eve. All those things that it says in Kabbalah about loving, love your neighbor as yourself, 19:18 Leviticus, Deuteronomy 6:5, thou shalt love the Lord thy God. All it says in Kabbalah about how to love or how to command an emotion so that you can use for interpersonal relationships. One of the things about thou shalt love the Lord thy God, the Maggid says, is meditation. That's the way you fulfill a commandment, through meditation. What should you meditate on? Meditation is a blah word. It has no specific. It has to be specific. Meditate on what?
Appreciation.
Let me just give it to you. These are all rhetorical. So what should you, on when you take a look at the person you're with, so conditional love, when the condition goes, the love goes. That's why Arabs take their 4-year-olds and then they exchange them for 2 20-year-olds. Yeah. That's what Muslims do, that's just their culture. But Jewish people, especially until they see a couple of generations ago, they would meditate on, if it's conditional love, you have a problem. It has to be more than the you and the I. A relationship, especially if it has the other reality added to it. I think you all notice I didn't do it, but actually, you know what? If I had a
So there is a word meditation in Torah?
Hitbonenut. The word for meditation in Hebrew is hitbonenut. It's not histaklut, but it's hitbonenut. It means to think about the person in the beginning stages, when you would have done anything to be closer to the person.
Wow.
What is the definition of the identity of love in Kabbalah? What does it say about that? What's the thesaurus of the Torah in the secret teachings of Torah?
Knowing.
In terms of love. Do you know it? Did you read it? Are you guessing? So just listen up. It's dvekut. Love means wanting to be close. What's the Hebrew word for glue?
Devek.
What's one of the 650 commandments in the Bible? Ubo, and in him, capital H for him, God, tidbakun, from devek, dvekut. The identity of love is defined in Kabbalah as dvekut, cleaving to, wanting to be close to, kiruv, wanting to be close to a person. 12% of the married couples are in bliss, domestic harmony. I asked them all, the ones I know. Thank God I know a few dozen, not many. I asked them all and they said, cliches. I asked them all, how come everybody knows you're a happy couple? Not only I know it, okay, people can find me, but people around you look at you with envy. Everybody sees, picks it up, that you're really together. They use cliches. But when they told me the cliches, it wasn't people around, it was eye contact. Person's soul comes to their eyes, I saw they're telling the truth. It's a beautiful thing to see. She's my best friend. I hear it a lot. Very few couples use it. She could have girls night out, he could be well broken with a one night over a loop with the boys. But there's two different kinds of love. Ava kirish pe'esh. Love like fire. I'm talking about the Kabbalah now. I'm not telling you poetry I read. I'm talking about God's wisdom in his book. So that's just it makes no sense to guess. It's in the book. And Ava Kamayim. Love like water. What's love like fire? Love like fire, that was passion, yeah. But where does it come from? It comes from being apart, being distant. You want to be closer. You define love as being wanting to be close. The vekut, cleaving to, kiru, going to be in close proximity. Being pained when you leave. Bye. I was somewhere. My wife taught a class, and the guy is coming down the beautiful home, coming down the staircase. And she says to him, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night. You know what she meant? She's not going to see him. He's leaving for the day. He's a wealthy man, works very hard, provides very nicely, but he's an absentee husband. He complained to me that he bought a new car and a mink stove. And she left the keys in the car, and the mink stole the driver's seat. Surprise, it was stolen!
Wow.
A lot of money. And he complained to me, I worked my butt off, and she doesn't care about that. You stupid jerk, you. She doesn't want the car. She doesn't want the mink. She wants what you're not giving her. You're not there. That's not what she wants. You're not giving her what she wants.
We don't know. Maybe she's comfortable. We don't know. People can be comfortable.
I know her, darling. I'm talking about someone I know. You don't know her.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, okay. Now just zip it up. Yeah. Zip it up. Yeah. I can hear you anytime. Okay, I'm giving you 44 years of true life experiences. You got to recover anecdotal wisdom as opposed to relative, as opposed to us professionals. And a lot of times you can say, like I was saying to the people, the Jewish Mental Health Association of Los Angeles, we met once a month with 20 people, the constituency of 20 practitioners in the thousands. We threw out a one-liner and see if we could, how close we could come to unanimity. Now, if experience is the best teacher, and there is no wise sage like a perfect experience, you get 20 people in a room once a month, and you put out a one-liner, and you get back 90% of the same end, of the same idea, so you want to something. So I said that I think that 70% of therapists are either dangerous and detrimental, or at best, nothing.
Wow.
And they said, you're wrong.
Well, why did you say
that? Hey, let me finish. And here comes the punchline. Sip it up, my God. They disagreed with me. Don't you want to hear the disagreement?
Yes.
85% are no good. That's what 15 therapists and 5 rabbis. 85% of them. And we went through the statistics, 62% are getting divorced. Okay. Now you got 38% left. 10% don't have the cojones to get divorced, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, now you have 28% left. From the 28%, 10% are, okay, it's bearable, it's tolerable, but I mean, I'm not in bliss, okay? Now we're down to 18%, chai. We got some 18%, okay, let's say 15%, bargain, sold. 15%. So after 15%, what's the secret? Why are you guys happily married? And again, cliches. This is, if I asked, let's say 2 dozen couples, maybe a little less, maybe just 20 couples, something like that, of exemplary relationships, married couples. Some of them are second marriages, a lot of them second marriages. Or more, whatever. But I asked them, what's your secret? I deal in tragedy. Give me some wisdom. And this was, now, let's say these 20 couples I asked separately, and when they all say almost the same words, we work on it every day. That was the quote. And they said it in truth. It just me and them. We work on it every day. That means it needs to be worked on every day. Some men have a mistaken idea that once you're married, you know, this couple, a very good friend of mine, he was like a rock and roll lawyer, and she was a women's feminist group in the 60s, and they're living together for years. And every day, he gets up, and there was always breakfast. I mean, they live in a beautiful place. So one day he gets up, and he says, Zelda, not her real name, Zelda, we dropped acid last night, and I proposed to you. What did you say? And she says, I said yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, great, wow, okay. So, yeah, we got married. He goes into the breakfast room like he has for the last 7 years, and he goes, Zelda, where's breakfast? She says, what, are you paralyzed? Get it yourself. They get married, you know what I mean? So, a lot of times that sort of changes the situation. But what was another one-liner out of this Jewish Mental Health Association group? Was, the secret to a successful marriage is to continue dating your wife after you marry her.
Wow.
Men don't get that. But as a rule, yes.
Rabbi, it's like the fault really is with the men. They're not bred or, you know, born to know how to do all these things. You know, they're interested in their jobs. They just want to, you know, have sex and go back to work or whatever it is, you know. And women are more these emotional beings that know how to relate. And they
prove
it's proof. They go to their
girlfriends
and everything. So maybe the thing is, you
got to
teach the men how.
But
women
are
perfect.
Women
have
are absolutely
spiritual
perfect.
Responsibility in the house.
They never make any mistakes. The women.
No, they do and everything. But the problem is, they get dissatisfied because of the maybe the man is not.
Women have to be responsible, more responsible for the spiritual aspect of what's going on in the house.
I don't think she's doing
yeah,
that.
Yeah, but I'm not talking about that. I'm just talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah, she's not talking about spiritual.
Yeah, just basic.
I do want to say one thing about that. And the there is a thing about women expecting men to be more psychic than they really are.
That's true.
You know,
you're right.
Like 3 days later, he sees something's wrong. And he says, "Darling, is something wrong?" "No." "Well, you know there's something wrong."
"Yes, that's right."
And you get that kind of no. And what happened? Nothing. Okay, you know, I give up. Whatever. Can we? I don't want to do this because I feel inadequate, and I don't. Please tell me what I did wrong, you know. "Well, remember we were you were insensitive. You made a comment. You're right." But, I mean, my wife buys me the refrigerated magnets. He finally said those three little words. You could imagine, you know. I said, "Dog, I said I love you last week. Is there a problem? I mean, I haven't changed my mind. I mean, what do you need that constant reason? No, I don't get that part. You know, I love. I mean, what's the?" You know, he finally said those three little words. "I was wrong. Because men can't do that. You know, it's kind of a guy thing." And but well, anyway, there's different people have different runs. But I just got this thing about it's not working anymore. Yeah, how can God command that emotion to, it's not the emotion, but it's the meditation on my significant other, my partner in life, the parent of my children. It's a true love means one, but our nature draws us to materialism and consumerism. Now, going back and forth, the practical value again of Kabbalah is, he's teaching you about God, but it helps for interpersonal relationships. Adultery is one of the cardinal sins in the Bible. The 613 commandments, there's three cardinal sins. A cardinal sin means, if there are 610 commandments in the Bible, someone says, points a gun at your head and says, "Eat the hamburger," and you can say, "Can I have some ketchup?" I mean, whatever. You know, but the thing is that you don't kill yourself. For three, adultery, idolatry, and
murder.
Those are the three cardinal sins. So adultery, I mean, what's so bad about that? It's a non-crime kind of thing. And it's a sacrifice of life for that. Because true love means what?
Always have to say sorry.
The idea of having the other woman, whether the other woman is the computer, or it's the job, it's adultery. True love is one. That's your significant other. Everything, every other relationship you have is your somewhat secondary, tertiary, or insignificant other. Whatever it's, you know, people are computer widows, or whatever. It's not the way it goes. So that the idea of, again, picking yourself up one level in terms of the level of your love. It has to be exclusive. Everything else can be whatever, a second advice. Yes?
Rabbi, did you talk about the love as water? You said it's love.
That's true. The love of fire means you were distant, you got close. What does that mean? There's different kinds of love. Love of a parent, love of a sibling, love of children, and love of your significant other. Love of your significant other, ideally your spouse, means that once upon a time you were distant. You didn't know each other. And now you are significant others, but at the most intimate from any other person in the world. The idea, the Hebrew word for marriage, kiddushin, means also exclusive. There's an exclusive of what? There's only one God. More than one God, polytheism, idolatry, is one of the three cardinal sins. That's sacrifice your life not to do that. Adultery and idolatry. This is your significant other, bar none. Yeah.
Kiddushin is the
name
for marriage?
Kiddushin is the name for marriage. It also means exclusive.
Doesn't it mean holy?
Yes, it means holy. It also means whore, prostitute, because she is exclusive for everyone. She has no connection, no love. So it means a lot of things like it all. What is this? What
and water, 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 water. The other love.
Oh, water. Water means that it's a flowing thing that you don't have to generate passion. You're in love sitting with your best friend. You have to always say, you're my best friend. I mean, you know, you have to jump up and down. The idea, we have a rule that ta'anuk timidi, what does that mean? Who knows? Ta'anuk timidi.
Constant pleasure.
Constant pleasure, eino ta'anuk, isn't pleasure. What's the best proof of that we can all agree upon? Being alive is the greatest gift that was given to humanity by God. But nobody jumps up and down every minute, I'm alive, I'm alive. You know, even if I'm a chocoholic, I mean, there's a point where 3 days, I mean. So the idea is that this living in pleasure with your significant other, whom you're happily married to, is that's called love of like water rather than like fire. And water puts out fire. The higher level of love is when you don't have to be jumping up and down and saying, I'm alive, I'm in love. This is the person, this is your best friend. You'd rather be with this person than any other person that you know.
Wow.
That's called being in love. So what does this say? What daily window? Oh, is most of, oh yeah, okay. So conditional love, we already learned, once the condition is gone, so the love is gone. I love her because she's beautiful. I'd say in 30 years she's not as beautiful as she was 30 years ago. You trade your 40-year-old in for two 20-year-olds? I can't. So, but if your love is not conditional, but it's unconditional, after it's all said and done, there's one love that's generated by your intellect. I love God because I'm alive, I gave him my life, I'm 69, I'm coming up on 69 Purims, and all the good things that God gave me, but that's an intellectual, rational love. Let's say things aren't going my way. I'm not so appreciative right now. We had a great marriage for 11 and a half years, and now this happened, or that happened, 20 years, and 17, whatever it is. If it's based on a condition, and the condition is no longer, then our relationship is in jeopardy. But after a while, people get that it's more than you and I. That's where you have to go into the next realm. Unconditional love can only be generated if you have one God. Not if you have more than one God. But most people have two, because they have two souls. The natural soul wants creature comforts, materialism, consumerism, the golden calf. I have two, I want four. I have four, I want... But the godly soul, the other part of your consciousness, the divine soul, in that double level of consciousness that you have, can look at your significant other and say, I have an unconditional love to this person. This relationship means more to me than... because it's part of me. Just like I love myself, and the closest person that I can be close to is myself, and my survival, natural survival instinct. So this is my closest person. This is the other half of me. What does it mean that Kabbalistically marriage is made in heaven? In heaven there are unisex souls.
Wow.
And they're divided into two. Neshama de Nukva, Neshama de Duchra. Feminine soul and masculine soul are counterparts of one entire totality of soul. And once you have a totality of a singular soul that has both parts to it, then you become like the origin of that soul. There's a fire, you have a burning ember, So the ember is just like that. It has light, it has heat, and it comes from that fuel. So in terms of tripping divinity, godliness, every time you do a mitzvah, it depends which kind of mitzvah you do. How about a married couple that comes together in the marital union? Even if they're older, she's pregnant, or he can't have you, whatever it is, every Kabbalistically, every time a couple comes together, they have children. Every time they're together as man and wife, spiritually speaking. So that mitzvah, according to the secret teachings of the Torah, trips the most energy of God into the two and the act of that they're together sexually. Yeah.
Could you say that again? It sounded very profound.
That was deep. Yeah, that was really good.
That's called the secrets of love, according to the secrets of Kabbalah. So, again, every mitzvah you do precipitates a flow of divine energy, divinity, godliness, into the perpetrators of that mitzvah and their surroundings. So here in this house, while us learning some Torah, the blessings of divinity are flowing into the house of all our Jewish souls and the Torah that we're studying. And we're grasping, not just understanding, but connecting to God. Because we said God wrote in the first word of the Ten Commandments in a secret acronym, I wrote my soul into this book. So you want to grasp God's soul? Study the Torah. Because in the first word of the Ten Commandments, it says, Anochi. What's nafshi mean, nefesh?
My soul.
I wrote my soul into this book, is the first word of the Ten Commandments. So again, what does it say there? So if you want to shift your attitude towards the spiritual reality, and that's the only way that you're going to ever be able to have unconditional love. But you have to go into another realm of consciousness. In this world, it's what have you done for me lately? And your significant other is just there for the person that's most important to you. Why? Are we having fun yet? What have you done for me lately? Unconditional love has to be altruistic. It has to be you and I is much more than you and I. And that's why you don't use a D word the first year of marriage. That's my rule. No one listens. But that's it, you scorch my and dinner's ready, I'm divorced. Yeah. So what's the time that's most opportune to get yourself into that groove of unconditional love to God, your significant other, or entering into spiritual reality? Saying the Shema. That's how the Kabbalists, the mystics of our concealed, hidden Torah says, Shema is not just another command for God to make you busy. Okay, let me see, let's keep these Jews busy. You know what? Okay, 611. Get up, say Shema twice a day. Get up. Let's figure out how to make these people. That's not the way it goes. It gives you a 3-minute opportunity twice a day to think about someone other than yourself. That's good practice for relationships. Getting you in the shmunk of, what have I done for my significant other lately? What am I saying once again? What daily window is most opportune to enter the commandment say Shema? Yes.
Do you recommend any meditation or any prayer for couples that they could do together, like meditate together to become closer?
You know, that's a great idea. I didn't think about it. I saw people before Kiddush on Friday night say the Ancient Chayim together. Couples say it together. In English. There's a prayer for the woman that the man says before he makes Kiddush on Friday night.
Eshet
Chayim. So there, I saw people read it together, couples read it together.
How do you spell that?
E-S-H-E-T-C-H.
It's a Hebrew word, so there's no real way in English.
It comes out.
Like how many ways to say the Hanukkah?
A-Y?
Yes.
I am.
You said
it's called woman of God.
C-H-A-Y.
C-H-A-Y. No, not he boninut, that's with the Dalit. He boninut with nun.
What's
the difference between the two?
Sorry?
What is the difference between Hibbodidut and
Hibbodidut? Hibbodidut is a crying out to God loudly. Mm-hmm. That's a breast of her specific thing. And Hibbodidut is more contemplative. It's not. It's kind of silent. Sometimes can be accompanied with a melody. Specific melody, that kind of thing. But it's more contemplative, thinking about God or your significant other, and God, especially at this time of difficulty, going back to why did I fall in love with this person in the first place? I mean, that kind of thing, you know? Let's play our song. If it doesn't work, oh, you need more information. If you meditate and you're not getting to the love, like the commandment, thou shalt love the Lord thy God, because that was our original question, remember? How can even God command an emotion? The same idea of contemplation or meditation on what has God done for me lately, every second I'm alive, is a lot. Because that's the greatest gift, again, God gave to humanity. So that's one of the things. But we Jews have a special smichik that others don't have. We're among friends, so I can be truthful. There's something in our soul called Ahava Misuteret. What's Misuteret mean?
Contradictory.
Hidden love. That's, yeah. Hidden love. In Jewish DNA, from our patriarchs and matriarchs. Definition of a Jew is someone who comes from the seed of Abraham, our father, and our matriarch, the first Jewish woman, Sarah, and our father, Isaac, and our mother, Rebecca, and our patriarch, Jacob, and our mothers, Leah and Rachel. If someone is from that seed, has that DNA, it means they have something called Ahava Misuteret, a hidden love inside their soul.
What?
A hidden love for God. So this hidden love for God in their soul that came from the patriarchs and the matriarchs, they can be submerged for generations, and even if people not know they have it. Like a flintstone has fire in it. Even if it's underneath a lake. If it's been underneath a lake for 100 years, you take it out, knock it on another flintstone, you're going to get a fire. Jewish souls have a flintstone of hidden love inside their soul. In the conversion process, Kabbalistically,
wow.
When a person goes beneath the water to immerse themselves in the last stage of conversion from being a non-Jew to a Jew, that's when they get the extra smichik of Ahava Misuteret, hidden love. The good news about hidden love is every Jew has it. The better news is you can push a button and access it. You have the power at any time to do that. However, it's best with ideal conditions prevailing. What does that mean? It means that, you know, the lights should be low, the music is playing, it's not, you have time, you have time, and it's just a clam running out the door, you have 5 minutes, what are you talking about? I mean, am I worth more than a quickie? What are you talking about? I'm your significant other. How about a little forward planning? Do you find out if I'm busy? I mean, did you bring, you know, was it flowers before or afterwards? How does it work? I mean, let's forget that, why should we even go out? Ideal condition prevailing is such a thing in the spiritual reality as well. When you light candles Friday night, it's called Butzina Kaddish in Kabbalah, holy light. Holy light is best with ideal conditions prevailing. How do you generate ideal conditions prevailing to make a spiritual connection? Because a woman has that opportunity around 18 days before sundown on Friday that a man doesn't have. How do you make it better? How do you make it more that it's going to be successful? Because the object of prayer is it should be your prayer should be heard. It should be accepted. Putting 2 coins in a charity box before you light the Shabbat candles doesn't sound like much. According to Kabbalah, you have a powerful way of your prayers being accepted. Since you already have that, you're empowered to access that inside you. That pushes the buttons in your soul to make, like the psychologists talking about subconscious and unconscious. Now, more probably to say unconscious. But you can shift the spiritual reality that's in your unconscious to your conscious mind when you do and have these opportunities. This of hidden love. Yeah, that's the Ahava Misoteret. So everybody has it. When you say the Shema, is the most ideal. Okay, we said that already. Love definition is being close. Self-love was this degree according to
degrees of pleasure.
Oh, degrees of pleasure. Okay, love like water and fire. Ahava Pirish Pe'esh. And fire, that's easy to passion. And then the water, it's calm. It's even cold. Fire is hot. You can have love, it's cold. It doesn't mean it's not a value judgment. Okay, now learn what arouses love. Chapter 32 of Tanya. That's also significant. How do you say 30 in Hebrew? You know, the numerology, letters and numbers, alpha is one, beta is two, gimel is what? Lamed is how much?
30.
30, and bet is?
Two.
So chapter 32, the classic work of Kabbalah, of Hasidic mysticism in the Tanya, is the chapter of Lamed Bet, the heart. Look at the chapter of the heart in Tanya. The first sentence says it all, and then it goes to other stuff, details. What's the first sentence? Your initial of your name is not the last letter, it's the first letter. The power of your name is in the first letter. And then there are the details.
Wow.
So the idea of chapter 32, before that, it talks about a lot of different things. Chapter 32 starts out, V'habeninihu, about a normal person, not a saint, not necessarily even a very, talks about an average intermediate, a normal person. Love your neighbor as yourself sounds like an impossibility. There's nobody I'm going to love like me. We just said this is in the Torah. Adam karov eitz latzmo. A person is closest to themselves. So, even if you're my significant, I mean, whatever. But if you're my significant other truly, then your life is my life. And how many times do we see people, you know, sacrificing their life for each other? How many times can older couples have married 50 years, they die in the same year, or even days apart, same week, same hour. You see it a lot. That what? How does medical science explain that one? Being in love is not something just for songs. There's a certain something to that. So what did it say in the chapter? In the chapter of the heart, in this classic book of Jewish mysticism, in the first line, if you truly want to love someone else, then it has to be a spiritual realm. You have to bring yourself into a spiritual level of consciousness. Because once you're in a physical level of consciousness, then it's kind of very concrete and very well you've done for me lately, and you are a spoke in my wheel, one of my creature comforts. That's not necessarily going to work for a very long time. But if we graduate from the here and now materialism, consumerism, golden calf, yada yada, to a spiritual realm of consciousness, the other reality, so then that's the way I can love someone else like I love myself. Because you are the ultimate extension of we are one. You and I are both, you know, the other side of the same coin. It's something else. Let's see what else. Any more secrets of the Kabbalah we have here? Conditional, unconditional love. Conditional love, we all know what's wrong with that. Unconditional love can only be if we have some sort of consciousness in a spiritual realm. I think that's it. Okay, it's time for the munchies. Thanks for listening, everybody. Thank you, Brad. God bless you, man.